Today really is just an introduction, okay? Starting next week, we're actually going to have handouts. There's going to be opportunities for you guys to take notes, ask questions, and things like that. But today, what I want to do is I just want to lay out the vision for what we're doing and why we're doing it and why we're changing it, okay? So the first question that I think all of us need to be asking is, what is Truth Matters Academy, okay? And how is this different from what we were doing before? So on Wednesdays, junior hires, you guys were gathering to do your Bible study. On Fridays, high school, we were gathering to do our Bible study. So what makes this different, okay? First of all, it's going to be open, okay? And what I mean by that is actually in the weeks to come, we're going to be making more of an effort to try to let the surrounding churches and schools specifically know that we are doing this as a way to train and equip you guys and the people that are that you go to school with to be able to share the gospel on campus, to be comfortable and confident in your faith, okay? So that's number one. It's going to be more open. We're actually going to be doing some promotion and some, marketing, I guess, is the way that you could talk about it, okay? So to that end, what we've done is actually we've set up a website. And what we're going to do is we're going to set this website up so that everything that we're talking about on Wednesdays, there'll also be resources connected to that, okay? The website looks like this right now. The web address is www.truthmattersacademy.com. I can't believe we got it, but we did, okay? So I'm very proud of that. Right now, it's just a bare-bones site that just has info about when we're meeting and all that stuff. But eventually, we're going to kind of pull this out, and it's going to be connected to Truth Matters Ministries, which is a website that we already have up and running that we're actually going to be redoing for the month of February, and it'll have specific resources to the things that we're going to be talking about, okay? So if, let's say, we're covering a topic like abortion, right? Then what we'll do is that week that we're talking about it, we'll have resources that are related to that up on the site so that after you guys learn about whatever it is that you're learning, then you can also be reminded to go back and look at all that stuff. And then at any given point, all of the lectures that are happening on Wednesdays, they will be uploaded to a brand new YouTube site, Truth Matters Academy, obviously. And that'll all be available online too. So let's say there was a talk you really wanted to come to, but you had a game or you had a violin lesson or something and you couldn't make it, you can always watch it online afterwards, okay? And all the handouts and all that stuff will also be available, okay? The focus for the next 4 months between now and May is going to be on doctrine and theology. So we're going to tie those two things together, right? So what we know about Christianity, what we know about God, Jesus, all of those things. And then we're also going to tie together apologetics and evangelism, okay? So if you went to the high school retreat with us a couple weeks ago, that's essentially the model that we're going after. So when we have talks about apologetics specifically, we're going to tie that together with evangelism. And so one of the things that we did was a couple weeks ago, we went out to the Valencia Mall and we had conversations with people, some surveys and stuff. We're going to basically do the same thing. So when we have the apologetics talks, we're going to combine that with evangelism training. And then that weekend, we're actually going to go out and do that. So that's the goal for what we want to do with Truth Matters Academy. Okay. Our partner, again, is Rasher Christi College Prep. The president of both of the there's basically two guys that are running it, and they are giving us support in regards to the apologetics and evangelism training. One of the main trainers for Rasher Christi College Prep is in North Carolina, and he does an amazing program where basically every Tuesday, him and his students get together, they learn about a particular topic, and then they go out to the streets in front of their church. They just have conversations for like another hour. A lot of people have come to Christ because of those conversations. And so our goal is to actually do and mirror some of the same things. That's a big stretch goal, but I think we can do it. Because of what I saw at the winter camp when we went out ourselves a couple weeks ago. Okay, now, why should I care? Okay, because I know this is a question that you guys are asking as you're looking at your nails, picking your nose, thinking about other stuff, okay? So why does it matter that we do this? Why should you care, okay? Number one is because of compartmentalization, okay? So compartmentalization is a giant word, but it basically means that when it comes to our faith, we have this idea that it's kind of carved out in our brains, okay? Or actually in our lives, right? So our faith isn't connected to everything in our lives, right? So you have your life with your family, you have your life at school, you have your life with friends, you have your life with, your hagwon, your after-school program, your sports teams, your whatever, right? And so all of those different people that you're hanging out with or groups that you're hanging out with or places that you are caused you to have a different mindset for everything, right? It's why we act a certain way when we're with certain friends and another group of friends, we act another way. But what happens is for a lot of us, we have compartmentalization that's happening with our faith, right? So when we come to church, we're Christians, right? And we think like Christians. But when we're at school, we think another way. When we're at home, we think another way, right? And our behaviors and the things that we think about kind of change depending on where we are. And actually, that's not a good thing, right? Because our faith should actually inform every single part of us from top to bottom. And so one of the things that we're going to focus on, and that's why we're tying doctrine and theology together and then apologetics and evangelism together, is because we want you guys to not compartmentalize your life, okay? So in general, your faith should inform what you believe about the world, and so therefore will inform the way that you behave. All of those things are connected. The moment that we start to separate all of that stuff is the moment that our lives become actually hypocritical, okay? And so we don't want to be hypocritical. We want to live faithfully. And so compartmentalization is a big problem, and we want to address that every single time we get together. So that's one of the things that we can pray for, right? Is God, help me to take my faith seriously in a way where it's all connected together, okay? So that's one, okay? You should care because compartmentalization is an issue, and we want to basically not do that anymore, right? Number two, right? We want to answer some big questions this semester. We'll just call it a semester, okay? We want to answer some big questions this semester. Questions like, what is the meaning of life, right? The things that you do on a daily basis often don't allow you to ask big questions, right? So when you're sitting there doing your math homework, when you're sitting there practicing the piano, when you're sitting there, you know, jogging and working out and doing all that stuff, you're focused on the task that's in front of you, okay? But when we gather on Wednesday, what I want to do is I want us to take some time to step back, ask some big questions so that when you're doing the detailed stuff, you have an idea as to why you're doing it, right? So a lot of times when I was in high school, for example, actually in school in general, you'd be sitting down in your math class and you'd be doing like geometry or something. You're doing like a proof, right? And you're thinking to yourself, when am I going to use this in real life, right? When I get a job later on as a famous lawyer, why do I need to know how to do geometry proofs? It's dumb. I don't need to know this stuff, right? And so what happens is you get bogged down and you start to doubt what you're doing, and it becomes very discouraging, and it leads you to stress out and leads to anxiety and all sorts of stuff. Okay. So the idea is, if you take a step back and you understand that the reason why you're learning all of this stuff is because all of these things help you to understand the God's universe better, that helps you to kind of push through and get the job done. So what we want to do is we want to take a step back. We want to ask the big questions. Why should we learn? Right? Is learning something that a Christian should be engaging with? Right? This is what I mean by compartmentalization, right? So if you're compartmentalizing school and faith, then those two things are never connected. So you're not asking the right questions when it comes to why you're doing what you're doing, okay? So as a Christian, should I love learning, right? And if I'm learning math, then I'm learning about how the universe is put together when it comes to specific mathematical concepts. So should that be interesting to me? As a Christian, should I be interested in it? Should I be putting effort into it? Right. So these are actually big questions that a lot of us, we don't take the time to sit and think about. And so Wednesdays is going to be our opportunity to do that. Okay. And then lastly, the reason why we should care is because we want you guys to be equipped for evangelism. This is really important. Okay. More and more, we're realizing that because we're not engaging with evangelism, it's difficult to care about what we're learning at church. But the more we're having these kinds of conversations with people that we care about, the more we care about the actual knowledge that we have. Again, a couple weeks ago when we were at the winter camp and we were out on the streets having conversations with people, the things that we were learning from the guest speaker were coming into play, right? Some people came up to me afterwards and were like, oh my gosh, every single thing that you guys said was going to happen, I went out and I had these conversations and all of those things happened, right? And I'm so glad that I knew X, Y, Z. And then some of you guys came back and said, well, there were these things that I was talking about, but I didn't remember how to respond to certain questions. I didn't remember how to talk about certain issues. And so what can I do to talk about these things? In fact, somebody texted me this week and was discouraged because they were having spiritual conversations with people, but they didn't know how to answer a lot of the questions that they had. And so they felt really down. They were like, you know, I feel horrible about my faith. What can I do to learn more about these things? And number one, I don't think anyone should be horrible if they're trying to talk about spiritual things with other people. If you don't remember exactly what we talked about, that's fine. Just the idea of you being out there having spiritual conversations, important conversations, I think is an awesome thing in and of itself. But now we want to take Wednesdays to actually equip you guys so that you're actually learning, okay? So let's start with a big question, okay? So as our introductory big question for Truth Matters Academy, the question I have for you guys is, what's the meaning of life, okay? I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes, okay, to talk to the people around you to try to figure out or you can just discuss what you believe is the meaning of life. You have 2 minutes. Ready? Go. What's the meaning of life? Oh, yeah, whatever breakouts you want to do. You can only go to 2 breakouts. I don't know. Because there's like 5 subjects, yeah, and you're only allowed to go to. I guess you can. I mean, I don't think it's a big deal. I think they're just trying to figure out how many people are going to go to whichever ones. Yeah. It's free. It's free, yeah. You can go to encouragela.com. Yeah, encouragela.com. All right, what's the meaning of life? Does anyone want to give me an answer? Attempt at answering this question? What's the meaning of life? Well, actually, that's a good question. So I don't know if you guys heard, Josh is really low. Manly voice. But he said, you mean from the Christian perspective? Well, I have a question. Does the meaning of life change depending on whether you're a Christian, a non-Christian, a Hindu, a Muslim? Do you think it changes? How many of you say yes? It changes based on... It's okay if you're not sure. You can raise your hand like this. Okay. Right? I think so, okay. How many say no, it doesn't change? The meaning of life doesn't change. It doesn't matter. Because I guess, okay, so this is actually good. I'm glad we brought this up. It's not something that I tend to talk about, but I think it's good, okay? Think of it this way, okay? We can approach this question in 2 ways, right? One way to approach this question is to say, there is an actual meaning of life, right? And there's a correct meaning of life. Right? And so whether you're Christian, Hindu, Muslim, or non-Christian, or you're an atheist, okay, non-theist, it doesn't matter, right, what you are, we're trying to figure out what the one is, okay? And then there's another viewpoint where you're looking at this question and you're saying, actually, because the meaning of life depends on what you want it to be, it really depends on whatever religion you subscribe to or who you are, and you get to decide what the meaning of life is, okay? So there's 2 ways of approaching this, but notice, okay, they're completely different, right? And so if you believe that the meaning of life is subjective, meaning based upon whatever I want it to be, then it can be anything, and therefore no one's wrong. But if you believe there's an objective meaning of life, meaning that there is a meaning that's outside of me, right, that I have to go search for and find, then there is a right and there is a wrong, okay? Now, here's what I'm just going to go ahead and give you the answer, but I think that if the meaning of life is subjective, right? If the meaning of life is subjective, then the search for the meaning of life is completely dependent on how you feel, okay? And so at the end of your life, right, let's just pretend that you get to live to be 80 years old and you get to die peacefully in your sleep. Let's just the best possible death scenario that we could possibly think of, the easiest way to die. Okay, and you know you're going to die. It's one of those situations where you're going to lay in bed, your family is going to be surrounding you, and you know you have 5 minutes left, okay? What are you going to be thinking if the meaning of life is subjective? What you're going to do is you're going to run through your life, and you're going to ask yourself, am I satisfied with the way that I lived? Okay? Then it means that you get to create the meaning of life, okay? On the other hand, if the meaning of life is outside of you, right, then as you're dying, and you have 5 minutes left, you're going to be thinking about, have I done enough to reach or find and discover what the actual meaning of life is, and have I lived according to that purpose? Okay. So even a question like this really depends on whether or not you believe that there is a God out there or there isn't a God out there. Okay? Because if there's no God out there, then you get to create your own meaning. But if there is a God out there, then the question that we have to ask is, did this God set up the universe in such a way where there is actually a meaning? Okay. Now, for the purposes of our discussion here, we're actually going to assume that this is from a theistic perspective. Okay, so we're going to assume that there is a God. And actually, I'm going to tell you what the meaning of life is from the Christian perspective. Okay, what does Christianity teach us about the meaning of life? Right. There's a book that I'm reading right now from Greg Cole called The Story of Reality. And it's a really, really good book. I'm actually thinking about using it as our summer study this year because he basically provides a way of looking at everything in the universe and asking the question of which worldview makes the most sense of everything that we know about the universe. And he makes the argument that Christianity makes sense of everything, right? So, talking about that, one of the ways in which we can learn about the meaning of life is to take a look at what have Christians in the past talked about when it comes to big questions, okay? So there is a document, okay, called the Westminster Catechism, okay? And the Westminster Catechism is basically a series of questions and answers that Christians, like, you know, hundreds of years ago used to teach their kids the faith, okay? So parents would sit down with their children, and they would ask these questions. And the number one question in the Westminster Catechism is, what is the chief end of man? In other words, what's the meaning of life? What's the reason why men exist? What's the reason for mankind being here? Okay? And the answer, I don't know if anyone knows this, is man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. This is totally worth memorizing. Okay? It's only the first question. What is the chief end of man? The chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Okay? And it turns out that this answer isn't just coming from wise Christians, but it's coming from the Bible itself, right? Romans 11:36 says this, "For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen." Okay, so this is that first part. Man's chief end is to glorify God. Okay, and then there's another verse. Philippians 4:4-5 says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice." Okay, and it's that second part. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Okay, now if you went to the Utah mission trip with us, here's a verse that you've memorized. Okay. John 17:3, "And this is eternal life, they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent," right? Because the question is, how do we do this, right? How do we discover what the meaning of life is? The meaning of life is to glorify God and to enjoy him fully. How do we do that? Well, Jesus himself tells us in John 17:3 that this is eternal life, this is the meaning of life, that you know the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent, okay? So this is the whole purpose of why Christianity is the way that it is because it's designed for us to get to know somebody, right? And that somebody, knowing that somebody and having a relationship with that somebody is the meaning of life, okay? It is that relationship. And what's funny is, to some degree, in some small version, we have a romanticized version of this, right? Because a lot of you guys love watching Korean dramas. You love watching TV shows and stories that dramatize love, right? And there's this idea that if the perfect guy meets the perfect girl, they'll live happily ever after. That's all you need to find meaning in this life. And it's because we're relational beings, so that's why when we think about people who have the perfect relationship and we think, oh, they found the perfect relationships, everything's going to be happily ever after, that comes from somewhere, right? That idea that that's actually true. And it turns out it's because God's created us with that in mind, right? He's created us as relational beings because he's a relational being. And so therefore, the things that we want most in life come from this idea that that's what we want with God most. The Apostle Paul, right, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 8 and 9, he says, "Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him," right? The Apostle Paul is saying that the most important thing in his life, that he would throw away everything, is the knowledge of Jesus Christ, his Lord, my Lord, okay? And so the question is, how do we do this, okay? So these verses teach us, right, that the way in which we find meaning in life is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. And they tell us that the way that we glorify God and enjoy him forever is to engage in relationship with God. And so the question is, how do we do this, okay? So for example, if you see somebody, okay, that you think is really beautiful and smart and intelligent and handsome or whatever, okay, and you really want to get to know this person, how do you engage in that relationship? What do you have to do? You have to walk up to them, say hello, introduce yourself, right? Ask them out to dinner or coffee or whatever, okay? I mean, I don't know how many of you guys are brave enough to do that, okay? But you should try it sometime. It's worth risking your life, okay? But the question is, how do we do that with a God, okay, who we can't introduce ourselves to? Like, you can't just walk up to God and be like, "Hello, God, my name is Kevin, and I would like to take you out for coffee. Would you mind putting all your universe stuff down and joining me for a cup of coffee?" And it doesn't work like that, right? So how do we do this, okay? Well, it turns out that we do it by using our minds, okay? John Piper says this, "Therefore, the main reason God has given us minds is that we might seek out and find all the reasons that exist for treasuring him in all things and above all things. He created the world so that through it and above it, we might treasure him. The more we see of his surpassing greatness and knowledge and wisdom and power and justice and wrath and mercy and patience and goodness and grace and love, the more we will treasure him. And the more we treasure him, the more he is consciously and joyfully glorified," right? So it's a longer quote from John Piper, but basically what is he saying? He's saying that God gave us the tool for us to be able to engage in relationship with him. And the way that we engage in relationship with him is we use our what? Our mind. Now, some people may say, but what about the heart? Okay, well, I have a question. Does your heart actually do anything other than pump blood between your body? No, because the heart is not, when we talk about loving somebody with all my heart, we're not saying I want to love them with the organ that's pumping blood through my veins in my body. Because that doesn't make any sense, right? What we're saying is we want to love them with the emotional part of our mind, okay? So when John Piper's talking about the mind, he's talking about all of the mind, not just the intellectual side, but the emotional side as well, okay? Solomon writes this in the Proverbs, okay? He writes in chapter 2, "My son, if you receive my words and treasure up my commandments with you, making your ear attentive to wisdom and inclining your heart to understanding, yes, if you call out for insight and raise your voice for understanding," and look at verse 4, "if you seek it like silver and search for it as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding," Okay? So the idea is that when you exercise your mind, okay, and you exercise your mind to pursue God, to chase after God, what does it say in verse 4? If you seek it like silver and search for it as hidden treasures, verse 5, you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Right? This is why God says, right? Jesus says in Revelation, ask, actually in the Gospels as well, seek and you'll find, ask and you'll receive. Right? The idea is that we're chasing after God with our minds. So what does it mean that we do? It means that we think. Okay? We have to think about God. We have to think about Jesus. When you are obsessed with a person, be it a celebrity or, you know, that girl in your class, right? Or that boy in your class, okay? You think about them, right? And some of you guys right now, when I said that, you're thinking about that person, which is why you're smiling right now. Because otherwise, what reason do you have to be smiling, right? Some of you guys are already thinking about that person. You're like, yeah, I think about them a lot, right? Yeah, you think about them, okay? And so the idea is that the way in which we engage in our relationship with God is we need to think about God, okay? There's a psalmist, right, Psalm 39, where this is what he writes, okay? He says, my heart became hot within me. He says, as I mused, what does it mean to muse on something? It means to think about something, right? To wonder about something, right? To dwell on something. He says, my heart became hot within me. As I mused, the fire burned, okay? Then I spoke with my tongue, right? So do you see how all of this fits together? So what do we want to do at Truth Matters Academy? We want to give you guys, right, tools to exercise your mind, your thought life. Right? The things you're thinking about, to focus on God so that your heart does this. It becomes hot with passion for God, and then what happens is you speak about him, you talk about him. Because what you're obsessed with in your heart is what you will talk about everywhere you go, right? So if there's a boy that you like or a girl that you like, you will talk about them all the time, right? Not with everybody, because you don't want them to know, but there'll be a few select group of people that you set aside and be like, oh my God, don't tell anybody, but I really like this boy, and he's so cute, and blah, 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 and I know everything about him, and I stalk him on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and Snapchat, and all the secret ones that old people don't know about, whatever social media you guys are using, right? And the people that know that you're obsessed with this person, every time you talk with them, you're just talking about them over and over and over again. And the idea is that that's what we want, okay? How do you get rid of compartmentalization? Is you become obsessed. And obsession comes from musing and thinking, okay? Now, why specifically is it important for us to get together to sit and think, okay? Well, it's because we live in a distracted age, right? The truth is, it is harder for us to have a relationship with Christ in this day and age than it was 100 years ago. Because 100 years ago, there was no TV. There was no, let's see, 100 years ago, was there radio? Yeah, there was radio. There was no TV, okay? Let's go 200 years ago. Okay, 200 years ago, there was no radio, there was no TV. I don't think there were light bulbs. Like, it hits nighttime, it's time to sleep, right? It's just, your day is done. There's nothing else for you to do, right? It was easier for people to think because you weren't distracted by all sorts of stuff, right? There wasn't a phone in your face all the time, or a screen in your face all the time, or music, or whatever, right? So we live in a distracted age, okay? It's really, really difficult, in fact, for us to focus on the things that we need to be focused on, okay? Psalm 27, right? This is a psalm from David. He says, one thing I have asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. This was a prayer, okay, that David prayed to God. And he says that the thing that he wants most is time to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. And so as a Christian, the question is this something that we want? what's really interesting is this, okay? The more you study God, the more you read God's word, the more you read books about God, the more you want to do that, right? That's what I've discovered in my life, right? When I was in college, okay, so my salvation story is pretty simple. I believe that I was saved at a very young age, probably in like during my VBS years, right? But I didn't really give my life to Christ until I was a sophomore in high school. And when I became a sophomore in high school, I gave my life to Christ. I submitted to him as Lord. I specifically prayed that prayer. I said, Jesus, I want you to be the Lord over my life. And I distinctly remember at that moment just really being convicted that what I needed to do was read the Bible. So what I did sophomore year was I read the entire Bible from cover to cover, Genesis to Revelation, from January to December of that year. Okay, I followed some Bible plan that took me through the whole thing, right? And then in junior year and in senior year, I became, you know, leaders of the youth group at the time. And then in college, I came back to the youth group to try to serve, and I did all of that stuff. But the funny thing is, like, because I had read the Bible, right? When I was early on in college, I was like, oh, I know the Bible because I read the Bible once. And I actually stopped reading the Bible because I felt like I should read other books. I should read Christian books. So I got really into that. But as I got older, the more I realized that the more that I actually came back to read the actual Bible, there's a draw for me to want time to go back and read the Bible, right? So consuming more of God's word causes me to want to carve out more time to then go back and consume God's word. And I think that's why David says, the one thing that I have asked the Lord, the thing that I'll seek after, the thing I'll spend my time doing, is to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple, to worship him in his temple, okay? And so, again, we live in a distracted age. It's very, very difficult for us to focus, okay? And one of the reasons for that is because we live in a mobile age, right? So it used to be that if you wanted to noodle around on a computer, you would have to be at a desktop, okay? The first computer I ever got has a processor, okay? The speed of the computer is 10 times slower than that of the processor inside my Apple Watch, right? And I did, like, played video games on that thing. I did video games on that thing. And I played games and video games. I'm going to admit this right now, but back then, computers were really expensive, okay? Like, if you wanted a desktop with a monitor, like a 14-inch monitor that was as big as, you know, those TVs that have things like that, where the back of the TV comes out like that. Like a 14-inch monitor, some speakers, a printer, and a computer. I remember it was like $2,000, right? $2,500 or something? Back in the 90s, okay? This was before even some of you guys were born. And I remember wanting one because I wanted to play games, okay? That was the only reason. But when I talked to my parents, I said, hey, Mom, Dad, I really need a computer. All my friends have computers, and I need it for school. And they were like, sure, you need it for school? Just lay down $2,500. Bought me a printer and a computer, and I used it just to play games, okay? Now, if I wanted to play games, what I would have to do is I'd have to go into a room, I'd have to turn on this loud computer, okay? And if I wanted to connect to the internet, I had to use a modem, okay? And a modem would make these sounds, okay? I'm sure you've heard the sounds like all this stuff, right? And then you connect to the internet, right? And you use a telephone cable that connected to your computer, right? Some of you guys don't even have landline telephones at home anymore, but that's what we used, right, back then. And we would, the internet was only fast enough, okay, for us to be able to chat with each other. Okay, that's how fast the internet was back in the 90s when I got my first computer. So I had a $2,500 computer setup, and the fastest thing that I could do was chat with people, okay? Which is basically, you know, texting, right? You couldn't even send pictures. Because if you sent a picture to somebody, it would literally get drawn line by line. And you'd have to sit there and wait, like, what is somebody sending me, right? And it would just come in line by line. And sometimes it would break. Because the internet was so slow, the picture would actually break. And you'd have to figure out what it is. And you're like, this is weird. I don't know that I want to know this. But now, right, you guys have, we have smartphones. We have computers on our wrists. Like this past Christmas, we got an Amazon Echo, right? I don't know if you guys have an echo in your house, right? But I could just walk around the house going, Alexa, do this. Alexa, do that. And it'll do these things, right? I mean, you know, they're not that crazy yet. Like, the first day that we opened it, my son Caden looked at the Amazon Echo, and he was like, Alexa, open this bag of chips. And he held up a bag of Doritos next to it. And Alexa said, sorry, I don't understand what you're saying. But now, again, okay, we have these supercomputers basically in our pockets, on our wrists, all this stuff. And so the idea is that it's very, 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 very easy, right? Very, very, very easy to be distracted, okay? Couple of really important quotes. The Harvard Business Review said this about mobile usage, right? It says, first, we are increasingly are overwhelmed with distractions flying at us from various connected devices. Smartphone and tablet use is spiking, and we now use digital media for an average of over 12 hours per day. This hyper-connected state does not allow us to process, recharge, and refocus. Now, what's interesting is the Harvard Business Review is actually a magazine, right, that's actually given out to business leaders across the U.S. So you know how they have what's called the Forbes 500 companies? So these are multi-million dollar, billion dollar companies. The Harvard Business Review is read by these kinds of managers. And there was a whole magazine issue dedicated to being distracted. And what's really interesting is that the CEOs of the companies that were receiving these things, they themselves didn't have this problem, right? So the CEOs of these multi-million dollar companies, they didn't have problems being distracted, but they knew that their employees did. And so that's why the Harvard Business Review had this this issue dedicated to that. Because if you're a CEO of a multi-million dollar company, you actually don't have time to be distracted. There are too many important things to do. But if you're just an average employee and you're not in charge of a multi-million dollar company, obviously it's much easier to be distracted. Okay. The New York Times last year had a really awesome quote that I want to read to you guys. Text is kind of small, but try to follow along. It says, a few neuroscientific studies reveal the extent to which we are dependent on our electronic devices and suggest how, in doing so, we may be impairing our reflective abilities. A 2015 paper in the journal PLOS One measured smartphone use via an app from participants aged 18 to 33 and also asked them to report their estimates. If the data is any indication, most of us use our phones more than we think. Participants estimated an average of 37 uses throughout the day, anything that turns on the screen from hitting snooze to making a call. The actual number was around 85. The slight majority took less than 30 seconds. Participants also underestimated duration of use by about an hour. The real total was 5.05 hours, which included phone calls and listening to music when the screen was off. If you're awake for 16 hours, turning on or checking your phone 85 times means doing so about once every 11 minutes and doesn't account for internet use on a computer, and 5.05 hours is over 30% of the day, what might be the effect on reflection of this compulsive behavior? Basically, they did a study, okay, and they did two things. They installed an app on the phone that actually tracked how many times you turn on the screen, right? And then what they also did was they asked the people that were taking the survey, how many times do you think you check your phone? And most people, the average they said was, we probably look at our phone about 37 times. That's what they wrote down. But the app is going to be accurate because the app is actually tracking how much you're using your phone. And what they discovered was that the people thought they only turned on their phone 37 times, but the app actually said they turned on their phone 85 times. And the crazy thing is, this study was done in 2015, okay? And in 2015, the average smartphone user was using their phone for a total of 5 hours a day. Think about that. 5 hours a day of smartphone use, and that was back in 2015. And we know that mobile use is only going up, so it's probably more now, because now we're in 2017. There was another study I read, and I don't have the statistics for this because I couldn't go back and find the article. So this is just me quoting from memory, okay? But they did a study of 15-year-olds, okay? This was a study that was done last year. They tracked 15-year-olds for 1 year, okay? And the average smartphone use for a 15-year-old, okay? Guess. Now remember, this study was done for 18 to 33-year-olds, okay? How many hours a day do you think a 15-year-old was using their phone? A wild guess. 5 hours, remember. 8.5 hours. 8.5 hours. And like people were freaking out about that number because you're only awake for probably anywhere from 16 to 18 hours, which means that half of the time that you're awake, your smartphone is in your face. That's pretty incredible, right? And that's average by, right? So that means some people were using it less, but some people were using it more, which means there were people that were using their phone like 10 hours, 12 hours. And I'm thinking to myself, what kind of battery lasts that long? All right, I have an iPhone 7 Plus, my battery doesn't last that long. So I don't know. I mean, I obviously these are people with massive battery packs and stuff. But that's a lot of hours. Okay. So I have a question for you. Okay. I have a question for you. If that's the typical behavior, right? Let's assume that you guys are typical of the 18 to 33-year-olds back in 2015, and you're using your phone an average of about 5 hours per day. Okay. Does your time then lend itself to thinking about God? Truth is, it doesn't. The truth of the matter is, it doesn't, right? In fact, we're at a distinct disadvantage now. Because the temptation to be distracted easily is right in our pockets, it's right in our hands, it's right in front of us. It's harder for us to be able to focus. So that's why time like this is actually really, really precious and really, really important, okay? But I don't want to end on a down note. I actually want to show you guys something that's really interesting. It's almost like God knew it was going to happen. It's almost like God's smarter than us, okay? which he is, by the way, okay? Galatians 5, 20 through to 24 says this, but the fruit of the Spirit, okay, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and what's that last one? Self-control. And then it says, against such things there is no law, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. The interesting thing is this. If you desire a relationship with God, okay, God has gifted you the Holy Spirit. And because the Holy Spirit lives inside of all believers, right, we have the fruit of the Spirit in us that's developing as we become mature Christians. And remember, this is not the fruits of the Spirit. Notice, look at verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit, which means what? All of these things is one fruit, right? So love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and then the last one, self-control. So if you're a Christian, if your relationship with Christ matters to you, you have inside of you the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit to have self-control. Which means that God has given us the tools that we need to be able to do this, okay? And what's great is part of that is actually being in the room together like this, okay? So just as by way of example and illustration, the people that aren't here right now, right? The people that aren't physically in this room, hearing this talk, engaging with God's word, thinking about these kinds of issues, they're actually not thinking about God. Most likely doing something else because, again, we live in a distracted world. But the fact that you're in here means what? That you're actually doing this. You're actually exercising this, right? Your decision to be here directly results in developing self-control, right? Unless right now you are distracted and you guys aren't taking notes on your phone and you're actually checking Snapchat and stuff, which could be possible. I'm hoping that's not it. I'm hoping that those of you guys who are using your phone, you're actually taking notes. Do you understand what I'm saying? So just by the physical act of you guys being at church or being a part of a small group or being a part of a discipleship group or whatever it is, for you to go and engage with other believers means that you're not looking at your phone, you're not being distracted, you are engaging with community, you are engaging with God's word. And therefore, your mind is active and therefore your heart is active, right? John Stone Street says this, God also uses distraction to strengthen our self-control. Christian self-control is a fruit of the Spirit, and like nearly all the Spirit's fruit of sanctification in us, they are cultivated through the primary decisive gift of the Spirit and our secondary but indispensable intentional hard work. Okay? What John Stone Street is saying is, look, what Galatians 5:22-23 teaches us is that number one, the Holy Spirit has given us the gift of self-control. But number two, we also have a desire to keep those distractions under control. And so what does that lead to? It means that if you put in intentional hard work to think about God, you will be rewarded for that. And that's exactly what we're doing here today. Okay? So what is Truth Matters Academy about? Ultimately, in the end, it's about giving you guys time and space to not be distracted, but to actually think and care about the things of God. Doctrine and theology, right? And then apologetics and evangelism, right? Remember, the two most important commandments is what? To love God and then to love your neighbor. And essentially, we're doing both of those things. We're learning the doctrine and theology so that we fall in love with God, we fall in love with Jesus, and then we're learning apologetics and evangelism so that we can love our neighbor. That's the point of Truth Matters Academy. That's the vision behind this. That's the goal behind this. And every single time we get together to meet, that's what we're going to be pushing on you guys over and over and over again. Okay? All right. That said, we're going to go ahead and close this time, and we're actually going to be moving into discussion groups.